lesson of the day. Turn with me to John 18. John 18. Beginning in verse number 4. John 18, verse number 4. The word reads as follows, reading from the NASB. So Jesus, knowing all the things that were coming upon him, went forth and said to them, "Who do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus the Nazarene." He said to them, "I am he." Judas also, who was betraying him, was standing with them. So when he said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Therefore he again asked them, "Who do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus the Nazarene." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these go their way to fulfill the word which he spoke. Those whom you have given me, I lost not one." Master, as we go into your word, as we discover the riches of your truth, pray, Master, that the lesson at hand, the lesson to be learned this morning, is a lesson for our heart. Let us try not to look to our neighbor, wondering if this lesson is for them. Let us look within our own selves, Almighty God. The lesson that is before us is for us. As your children, as the individual, as the church, as your people, may it be tied and bonded to our hearts. In Jesus' glorious name we pray. Amen. Before we can really get into today's study, we look at last week's sermon, the details laid before us in John 18, 1 through 3. Look at the significance of the place last week of where Jesus went to pray. We studied even the riverbed in which he crossed to get over to that historic garden, the Mount of Olives. We need to look at the details. Too many times we read the Bible and we gloss over his word and not get into the details of God's word. The details in which we find so much that can be applied to our life. We need to look at where and why Jesus was suffering so much the night before he went to the cross. We need to know what he prayed during this time in this historic event, and why he prayed those things. So let us look at some details that John doesn't give us in his gospel that we can find in the other Gospels, to better see what our Lord went through the night before he was crucified for us. Let us turn our attentions to Matthew chapter 26, if you will. And And as we turn to Matthew 26, let us focus in on verse 36. This portion of the timeline in which we are studying is right after verse 1 through 3 in John chapter 18, and just right before John 4 through 11. The meat that we're about to study is a powerful indication of what Christ went through. The suffering, the sorrow that he endured that night. Matthew writes in verse 36, reading from the King James Version, "Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane. And saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then said he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. Watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples, and finding them asleep, and said unto Peter, What could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then cometh he to the disciples and said unto them, Sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise. Let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that does betray me." There's some very interesting points in this passage that we really need to dig into. Jesus was at the very doorstep of his crucifixion. The next day, he will now take on the sins of the world, and he will be crucified, not on his own behalf, executed for the sins of others. The realization of what is about to take place grieves our Lord and Savior to his heart. What is grieving him? Why is he so passionate? Why is he so distraught? It's amazing that when we look at these first three verses, as he goes to the place called Gethsemane, and as he says to his disciples, Sit here while I go and pray, he does something that he has done in the past with three of the apostles. He tells the followers to sit in a certain area, and then he picks out three of them. Peter, James, and John. James and John, the son of Zebedee. He brings the three further along, and
The first question that should enter our mind and our hearts is, why the three? Isn't this a lesson for all of them? Why would God pull out three disciples and bring just the three with him a little further with him in order to study, in order to watch, in order to see a little bit more than the others? Are these disciples, are these apostles more important than the others? This wasn't the first time, once again, this has happened. We can pinpoint another occasion when he took the three up to the Mount of Transfiguration. Do you remember the story? He had the rest of the disciples wait, and he calls up the three and he says, "You three, come with me." The same disciples that he calls here in these verses are the same three he called previously. Let's say that's kind of odd. Looks like he's playing favorites. Like there's favoritism. We know in Romans chapter 2, verse 11, that God is not a respecter of persons in the sense that God doesn't play favorites. In his eyes, we're all his children of equal value and equal worth. So why the three? Why is it that he calls the three a little bit closer to him? What is this? Why is this so? What it is that we see is that these disciples, these three, were always the ones that wanted to draw closer to Christ. If we don't learn anything else today, one thing we can depend on, as we read in James 4:8, is that the closer we draw near to God, the closer he draws to us. If we want more God, he gives us more of him. These three had an uncanny ability to want more of Christ. And they weren't going to be denied by Christ. You want to see more? I'll show you more. You want to learn more? I'll give you more. I'll teach you more. And that application is very true today, isn't it? The closer we get to God, the more God shows up. As a kid, we would travel up the mountain of Mount Crystal Ray. The first time I saw it, first time I knew I was going to climb this mountain, Jesus was on the cross at the top of the mountain, and he had to be 2 inches tall. Amen? And the closer we got going down the freeway, getting into Sunland Park, going out to Mount Crystal Ray, the bigger he got. I looked at a distance and I said, well, that hill isn't going to be too bad for us. It's just a hill. The mind of a child, right? Mm-hmm. By the time we park at the base of the mountain and started climbing toward that cross, the bigger Jesus got. I'm talking about a statue. I'm talking about, and it was work to get there. You guys aren't listening to what I'm talking about. It was work to get closer to that statue. It was sweat. It was heat. It was work. There's times in which I said, you know what, let's rest a little. There's time when I said, why are we even doing this? He looked perfectly fine from back there. Amen?
Amen.
And as we got closer and as we got closer, guess what? Jesus got bigger and bigger and bigger. That little 2-inch Jesus from the distance when I was at his feet was so big I couldn't see how big he really was.
Amen.
And that's what our God is in our spiritual life. It takes a little work, but once we begin that climb to get more of God and to be closer to God in our life, the bigger he gets.
Amen.
Take some work. You can't just run up on them in one day. Amen. Takes a little sweat. Takes a lot of effort. And at times, as we're getting closer to God, we get a little weary. Halfway there, we might get a little discouraged. But when we're at the feet of Jesus, He's bigger than we ever thought He could ever be. The disciples desire a closer look at Christ. They desire a closer relationship. My old pastor used to say, when the student is ready, the teacher will come. When the believer is ready, then God will appear. But I got to warn you, it's to a point where He's bigger than we'll ever imagine. The closer we get to Him, the bigger He is. Amen? And these three disciples, although their intentions were great, let's look at what they say about these three. Jesus calls them up. In verse 37, come with me. And in verse 38, He says, my heart is broken. See, they don't realize the work that God is about to do in the Son's life. They don't have full gravity of what is about to occur. But Christ does. We come to the Father thinking that the world revolves just around us. We don't see the gravity of what He's dealing with. But He does. He says, my soul is exceeding sorrowful. And it's at the threshold. I'm at the threshold of death. He says, wait here. You see, no matter what was going to take place, bringing in the three disciples, they can only come so far. Because the work is about Christ. Amen? When we come far enough and God says, you come far enough, He says, wait here and watch as I work. Too many times we want to get involved in God's work. He says, wait right here and watch. The word says, tarry. He says, and watch with me. See what happens. Hear what happens. Be a part of what's going to happen. You can only come so far, but I want you to watch. Too many times our Lord tells us to sit and watch. We don't have time for that. Amen? Amen. Living in an instant society, living an instant life, eating instant oatmeal and using a microwave to nuke everything. We don't have time for that. Just show me what I need to see so I can move on. Jesus says, sit down and watch. Jesus says, after He's told them to watch, He goes a little bit further. The word says that when He went further, He fell on His face and prayed. We know it isn't the position of our bodies, but the position of our hearts that the Father listens to. But boy, is it such a joy to the Father to see that your flesh is following your heart in full submission. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Holy One, the Innocent One, the Perfect One, is in full submission, laying on His face before the Father. And begins to pray and say these words. Oh, my Father. When you pray, do you pray as though God is a faraway God? Are you able to call him Abba, Father, Daddy? See, it's personal when you can come up to him and say, Daddy. He says, oh, my Father, if it is possible, if there's a way. Now, we know God can do all things, but fail. Amen?
Amen.
He says, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. If it be possible, if there's another way, let this cup pass from me. What does he mean by that? What is he speaking on when he's speaking of this? The cup that he is referring to in this passage is the very cup of judgment that comes from God. God will judge all unrighteousness. God will judge all sin. And the way he judges all unrighteousness and all sin is he comes and he places his wrath upon it. And once he does that, it's non-existent. That is the judgment and the power of God. The cup that Jesus is referring to isn't a cup that is of his own. It's the cup of judgment that comes from the Father. He does not want to endure the wrath of his Father. So he's asking his Father to let this cup pass. If there's any other way that sin can be taken care of, that sin can be eradicated, that sin can be moved, let's do that. He didn't say amen and get up. That was his petition. Now we're going to see God's will. Nevertheless, do you see that? This is the Son of God. This is the one and only. And he finishes his prayer by saying, it's not what I want, though. Amen?
Amen.
Do we see that? Are we there? Do we understand that? That even when we pray, we give him our request, we give him our petition, but we need to understand, no matter our request, no matter our position, our petition, it is his will.
Amen.
That's what makes him God. That's what makes him Lord. He says, nevertheless, not as I will. Your will. This is the lesson. Father, this is what is on our hearts, but you now tell me what is on the agenda.
Amen.
Amen? Amen? That's what makes him God and not Santa Claus. Somebody say amen.
Amen. Amen.
We don't need a Santa Claus, we need a Savior. Verse 40 puts me in a little bit better position, in a better light, where I'm not so hard on myself about my service and my life in Christ. Amen? Look what he says in verse 40. And he cometh unto the disciples. Jesus is sorrowful. His heart is going through some things. He is stressed. He's anguished because of what he's about to endure. The wrath of God.
He told the disciples, sit here, wait and watch. He comes unto the disciples and find them asleep. I don't feel so discouraged. I mean, I'm a little discouraged at myself, but at least I'm not by myself. Amen. And he says unto Peter, what? Could ye not watch with me an hour? Is it too tough to do what I ask you to do? It's only for a short period of time. This is an hour. In the days of church today, in 2018, 2017, 2018, we're looking at our watch and say, well, you know, it's already 22 minutes. How long is this man going to preach? Amen? Game's on. Some of us don't even do that. We say it's been 22 minutes. You guys don't realize I can see everything from up here. Amen? He says, can't you stay awake for a little while? Something amazing's happening here. Jesus being our Savior, I'm sure glad he doesn't treat us the way we treat him. Amen. Jesus talks to the very three. Now understand, these are the three that wanted more of him. The other ones stayed asleep, but these are the three that wanted to see more, and once they were able to get a little closer, then they fell asleep. He wakes them up and he says the same thing. Watch and pray. Why should they pray? Because as Jesus is going into this passion, this dilemma, as he's going into this task, Satan is about and around. You see, if Jesus doesn't go to the cross, we're all lost. And Satan wins. So Satan is lurking. He says, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. He says, the spirit indeed is willing. You have the right heart, but the flesh is weak. You see, you're falling asleep. The days and the times in which we should be praying, don't we find ourselves falling asleep? Do you ever lay in bed and say, oh, I forgot to talk to the Lord. Lord, forgive me for all my sins. Thank you for everything that you've done for me. Oh, it was a long day. That's the end of the conversation. Yet he sits there and he waits for us to wake up. By that time, we're so late to go to work, we forget to talk to him on our way out the door. I thank God he doesn't treat us the way we treat him. Mm-hmm. He says, your heart is right, but your flesh is weak. He goes back and he prays the same thing. And the cup here is expanded. Look what he says in verse 42. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it. Cup here is expanded. We understand that he's not just talking about the cup coming down upon him in the wrath of God. He now has to partake in a cup that isn't his, and that cup is filled with our sin. This is a perfect Savior. A man who knew no sin will now have to take upon the sin the entire world and those that believe. The sin that I created yesterday, the sin that we'll create tomorrow, was in this cup. Was in this responsibility that he had to carry. 33 some odd years, and he has never been sinful. wants, he carries it all.
Yeah.
See, we don't understand quite the ramifications of this. I don't think we're going to understand until we get to heaven. We were born in this. We don't know anything but this until Christ gets into our heart. Amen?
Yeah.
All we know is sin. Because we're defiled. But holy and pure is Christ, that he takes on our defilement. Why is he so troubled by this? Because he is going to take upon something he has never had before. Our filth. Understand, this isn't a bad thing. Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
He's the only one that could. Amen.
Amen.
He came to do it. Thank you, Lord. He came to do it. But can't you see the struggle? That once this happens, we understand why he cries out, "Why have you forsaken me?" Turns his back on his son so he wouldn't turn his back upon us. Verse 43, and he came and found them asleep again. For their eyes were heavy, they were tired, they were exhausted. Aren't you glad even when we're tired and exhausted, God is still working?
Amen.
Jesus is still, he's still working. Praise God.
Amen.
He says these things. Goes to the disciples once again. Goes to them, and in verse 44, he left them and went again. He went off again to pray. The same prayer. Some people say when you ask God, he knows what you want. You don't have to keep asking him. Stop bothering him. Stop telling him what you need, what you want. He already knows, and that's not what he says. He says, come to me. Cast your cares at my feet. Come to me. Tell me. Yes, I already know, but I want you to communicate with me. Jesus is going again and praying the same prayer. The outcome is still the same. There is no other way. Did God answer the prayers of Christ? Of course he did. Jesus says, if there's any other way, take this cup from me. And God says, there is no other way. Tomorrow's the day. Tomorrow is the day. Then cometh he to his disciples and says to them, sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand. He says, now it has begun. I went to the Father and the answer has come. Now it's begun. The great passion of the Christ is set into motion. And we are now the benefactors. Those that believe. He says, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Jesus is now referring to himself, not of the Son of God, but he's speaking of his flesh.
You know, the Gnostics, a group of religious individuals, used to believe that Jesus Christ was God manifested in the flesh, but that Jesus Christ was spirit. He wasn't fully man. He was able to endure these things because he wasn't quite flesh. He wasn't quite man. He was man-like. And many of us believe, well, he could definitely handle it. He's Jesus Christ. But we don't understand the human side of it. He's flesh. When you cut him, he bleeds. He hurts. He weeps. He's flesh. And he refers to himself the Son of Man. Is betrayed into the hands of sinners. He's betrayed into the hands of you and I. And one of the greatest revelations that we can ever understand and make personal is the crucifixion, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the greatest of this revelation is this. If I was the only person to ever live, Jesus would come and die for me. Come. And it would be me that would kill him. He's betrayed into the hands of sinners. Sheep, the Lamb of God, prepared for the slaughter. Innocent blood shed for the children of God. Do you believe?
Yes.
Are you his?
Yes.
Do you believe that he died for your sin? Do you believe that he is resurrected and alive and well, sitting on the right hand of God? He closes by saying these words. He says, "Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that does betray me." The wheels are in motion. Redemption is nigh. And God's magnificence will soon be revealed. Is this a passionate story to you, or is it the truth in your heart? Is this story, is this passion a sad story in your heart, or is it the greatest accomplishment God has ever created for mankind? Is it sadness or is it victory? It all depends on whether you are a child of God or a child of Satan. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the examples that you have showed us about those that were born in the flesh, the apostles. We thank you. To know if we are willing, and we desire to draw near and get closer to you in all understanding that you will draw closer to us. Master, we understand today it's going to take some work, some desire, to draw nearer to you. We understand that sometimes we're going to have to go outside the box. We have to pray more. We have to study more. We have to meditate more. We have to commit more of ourselves in order to draw nearer to you, Father. To receive the promises that you will draw nearer to us. We thank you at times, Lord, that when we do draw near and you want to show us greater things, that when we do fall asleep, when we do get lackadaisical, when we do move away from what you're trying to show us, gently you wake us up, causing us to get back into focus. Sometimes it's not once, sometimes it's not twice, sometimes it's three times or more. We thank you that you don't give up on us. We thank you for the gentle nudge in our life, telling us to stay on track, stay focused. Because your magnificence, your grace, and your mercy is at hand. We pray that you continue, Master, to reach us. All because of the blood of Christ. The bridge that gave us access to a holy Father. In these sinful bodies. Because of Christ, we have life. Because of the cup, with all the pain and anguish it was to take up that cup, he obeyed your will even until the cross. We have full access. Full and complete access to you, El Shaddai, God Almighty.